So I've been reading up on some classic Shakespeare. You know, those teachers trying to get a little culture in my life. Here's what I discovered. I'm an idiot. I mean, it's all written in English, which is my native language, but I'm struggling through the classics, and I don't know what happened. I mean, that used to be the daily language in the 1700s and 1800s. So I looked this up. Shakespeare had a working vocabulary of 54,000 words. We in the United States today have a working vocabulary of
3,000 words.
That's why when we read Shakespeare, we're like, what light through yonder window breaks? It is the East, and Juliet is the... And right about there, we're like, does this come on DVD? So this really put me under the pile a bit. I mean, I'm not as smart as I thought I was. I mean, if I was born in the 1700s, presumably children have a bigger vocabulary than I have, which means I wouldn't be able to recite fairy tales like The Three Little Pigs, because I'm not smart enough. I mean, I'd have to be like, "'Twas a time not long past, they lived pigs in stature little and number three, who of an age now both entitled and inspired to seek their fortunes, did set out to do so thusly. When they had traveled a distance, pig numbered first spake, saying,
"'Hearken, brethren, and heed this tempestuous realm. Shall we tarry long, separated from hearth and home? We will fare, I fear, not well."
And so, being collectively agreed and individually impelled, the diminutive swine set about each to build for himself an abode. Pig numbered first did from straw construct his home. Pig numbered second did likewise, though rather not from straw, but from sticks. Meanwhile, being unique in his imaginings, pig number three did erect as his refuge, both stalwart and garish, a structure made of brick entirely. In time, there happened along, as is frequently the scenario in classic tales of protagonist piglet or red-hooded child, a wolf. Carnivorous nature in full season, he called out to the straw ensconced swine, saying,
"Prithee, little pig, grant me entrance."
First pig recalled with sage, foreboding that it is the madman who trusts in the tameness of a belly-pinched wolf. His reply in earnest,
"Nay, it shall not be, not by wit nor whisker jowl."
And so, to this most predictable response, the wolf replied,
"Then steel thyself, little pig, post haste shall endeavor, employing both means of huffing and puffing, to dismantle thy flexen fortress."
Whereupon the wolf did billow forth an exhale of gale-like force, quickly rendering straw hovel to dregs and dross, and carried aloft piglet and shattered quarters both. Exposed now to claw and fang, first piglet made haste, wolf in pursuit, to the stick festooned sanctum of care secondary. He called upon the inhabitant sow in urgent request.
"Brother, I've been purged of my straw home and sound judgment alike by yonder unabashed wolf who now seeks my demise. I pray thee, grant me entrance."
"Well, this knot's my knickers,"
cried second piglet as he unveiled his front portal.
"Now, where among these actions most considerate and amiable is the marshalling of feral wolf to my custom?"
"Apologies,"
declared one. Upon the wolf's arrival to the second pig's abode, he bellowed aloud yet again,
"Grant me entrance into this wooden domicile."
They replied in unison,
"Nay, it shall not be,
not by our wits nor whiskered jowls."
To this most predictable response, the wolf replied yet again,
"Then steel thyself, little pigs, for I shall puff and puff to dismantle thy flexen fortress."
The mighty maelstrom of the wolf's torrential exhale splintered the second swine shack and shortened their sanctimonious reunion simultaneously.
"Lo and behold!"
squealed two.
"Stand we in our mid wooden wreckage, tremulous and vulnerable, with nary a strategy for eschewing canine devour,
noble. To contemplate tactical particularities, pressed as we are with time restraints forbidding detailed strategical conversation, I urge...
We're up!
Whether by their own fleet-footedness or the wolf's windless attitude, the bats and porkers arrive at their ultimate kindred's inexpugnable brick ingress. Unscathed, upon the third pig's door, with urgent hooves they pounded,
Abort his entrance!
And with haste we beseech thee!
The third pig hailed from the American colonies, and possessing a vocabulary substantially less robust than his impromptu visitors, replied,
Say what?
Seek my sanctuary!
They implored on the verge of hysteria,
lest we fall forthwith to the ravenous appetency
of yonder approaching carnivore!
Still confounded by their words, Pig 3 rendered his portal ajar, whereupon 1 and 2 spilled through and collapsed beyond the threshold, inadverted.
So y'all just want to come in? You could have said that.
The hiss of the wolf can again be heard externally.
Pray thee, little pigs, grant me entrance!
The wolf!
Cried 1 and 2.
A wolf?
Said 3.
What you suppose he wants?
He seeks to gain purchase within. Indeed, he would occupy this very alcove where he afforded the most meager of opportunities.
Right. I'm going to ask him what he wants.
Under no circumstances,
squealed 2.
There is naught to be gained for accosting external opponent save our own immediate demise.
What did you say about my mama?
House and occupants were again engulfed in the malevolent blast of wolfish wind. The foundation shook, the frame rattled. And lo, to the astonished eyes of piglets and encroaching scoundrel alike, stood the third pig's lodging, undaunted. Aghast and befuddled, 2 queried of 3,
how does it get such relentless and torrential onslaught does this domicile endure?
Pig 3 puffed out chest, tapped a hoof to the hearth and responded,
it's American me.